Although this video is not all about JSON, I want to give you some little bit of introduction. JSON stands for JavaScript Object Notation. It is a text format for storing and transporting data. So why JSON? JSON is self-describing, easy to understand, and most importantly, since the format is plain text, JSON can easily be sent between computers and used by any programming language. So have you ever tried to convert and export your HTML tables data into JSON? If not, let's do this together. Hello and namaste everyone, this is Jitsar with Coding Design. Welcome to our channel. If you are new here, please be sure to hit that subscribe button. Let's change the title. For the title, I am giving convert and export HTML table to JSON. And with the help of live server extension, let's open this index.html file in our default browser. So this is the result, and all this code, they are taken from the last week's video. In that video, I have shown you how can you convert and export your HTML table to PDF file. Video's link will be given in the description below or at top right corner in I button. You can find it out, okay? Now, in order to convert and export this HTML file into JSON file, within that drop-down menu, we need to add extra button for JSON file. So this was the option that I have given for PDF file. So now let's duplicate the same option and let's change that ID. For ID, I'm giving to JSON, and also let's change that text. I'm giving JSON, and for the image, let's give JSON.png file, okay? And now in the browser, you can see we did add extra option for JSON file. And when you click that option, we need to convert HTML table into JSON, and finally we'll export. Now we need to select that ID to JSON in the script.js file. Let's copy the same comment and now paste it down there. Now instead of PDF, let's give JSON, and also let's change that number as well. I'm creating constant variable JSON button, and I'm assigning document.query selector. So we are selecting the label with ID to JSON. Now for the JSON button, I'm giving event handler, that is click. So for that, I'm writing JSON button.onClick. So now when you are clicking that JSON button or that JSON option at the time, we will call function name to JSON. And as you can see, we have already selected the HTML table, that is our customer table. So now we can copy that customer table variable and paste it inside that toJSON function as parameter. But as you can see, I haven't created that toJSON function. So now let's create that toJSON function. And I'm taking that customer table as table. Let's create table data variable, and I'm assigning empty array. So the reason for creating that array, it's because you might have seen like the structure of JSON file. It's something like this. Within the array, there will be different objects, and within that objects, you will get different key and value pairs. So it's something like that. So initially, for the table data variable, we are creating that empty array. Later on, we'll create different object and we'll pass that objects inside that array. Now let's create another variable thead, and again I'm assigning empty array, and also let's create another variable T headings, and I'm assigning table dot query selector all. So we are selecting the table heading, these table headings, okay? And also we need to select all the table data that lies within the table body. So in the script.js file, once again let's create another variable table rows, I mean T rows, and I'm assigning table dot query selector all, and we are selecting all the table data that is within the table body. So now we need to loop or iterate all the table headings. So for that, I'm using for of loop. I'm writing for T head of T headings. Now that T heading variable represents the each table heading. I want to show you the result in console. So I'm writing console.log. Let's give that T heading dot text content. Now in the browser, you can see we are getting all the text of that heading along with that up arrow icon. So that is a great problem. So in order to get rid of that icon, inside that for loop, I'm creating actual head variable, and I'm assigning T heading dot text content. So we are getting the text of that table heading, and along with that, I'm writing dot trim. So with the help of this trim method, you'll be able to remove all the extra white space if there exists at the beginning and end of the text. The technique that I have used in this video, it is a bit complex technique. So instead of this, we can make it much simpler. So if there is simpler technique, why would you use that complex technique? So I'm giving you much simpler technique. Let's comment out this code, and I'm writing console.log. Let's take that actual head variable and I'm writing .sobest here. It's an string method. With the help of this method, you can extract any specific part of string or text. So for the first parameter, let's give 0. That means starting position of text or string that you want to extract. Now you can see in the console, we are getting table headings with that up arrow icon. So we need to get rid of that. So for that, for second parameter, you can give the length of a string or the text that you want to extract. So for that, I'm giving actual head.length. So with the help of this length method, you can get the total number of characters that you have in the text. And if I write -1, that means we are getting rid of that last character that you have in your text. That means we are getting rid of that up arrow icon. And also, you can see between that text and up arrow icon, there is white space. For that, you could give -2. But what if there is like multiple extra white space in the future? So instead of that, I'm giving .trim. Again, that trim method, it will get rid of all the extra white space if there exists at the beginning and at the end of text. In the console now, you can see we are getting only the text of that table heading. If you have noticed there, each word of this table heading, they are starting with capital letter. I can give .to lowercase. So with the help of this method, we are transforming our text to lowercase. So once again in the browser, you can see now all the table headings text, they are converted into lowercase. And instead, in the standard CSS file for the table heading, you can give CSS property text transform to capitalize, so that will make our code easy to maintain in the future. Now we can cut this code and let's duplicate the same code, and instead of that code we can paste that code, and now we are pushing our new table's headings value inside that thead array. Okay, so this code is much more simpler, so you can use this. Let's console that thead. So now you can see in the console you are getting the array, and inside that we are storing all the values of that table headings text, and that doesn't contain up arrow icon. But if you had really simple HTML table, you don't need to write these codes. It's unnecessary. Now it's time to get all the table data. So for that, as you can see, I have already selected all the table rows. So now I can write something like t rows dot for each, so we are iterating each row, and within that callback I'm creating constant variable row objects, and I'm assigning empty object. So as I have already told you that within that array we'll be creating different objects with different key value pairs. And so let's create another variable t cells, and I'm assigning row. As you know, we are getting all the rows of that table body with the help of that query selector all. We are selecting all the table data of that specific row. So I can write something like t cells dot for each. So once again, we are using the same for each function to loop, and for each table cell, I'm representing it as t cell. And along with that, let's keep table cells index. I'm writing cell underscore I, and within that callback, I think it's better to give cell index. So now within that callback, you can give row object, and within that square bracket, we can pass table heading. As you can see, within that t head array, we have pushed new value. And next to that, again, you can give square bracket. Within the square bracket, you can pass that cell index. So with the help of this code, we are trying to store all the tables data that belongs to the exact table headings column that it belongs to. So I am assigning tcell.textContent. So we are getting all the table data's text, okay? Now let me show you in the console. So for that, I am writing console.log row object. Let's take this console one step up. So in the browser, did you see that? We are getting different objects, and inside that we are storing different key value pairs, and that key and the value, they are exactly matched with the table heading and the table data. So this is exactly what we want. As I have already told you that if there is any kind of white space at the beginning and at the end within the text of table data, we have to remove. So for that, I'm again using the trim method. But if you have noticed carefully in our table, along with different table data, there is customer image. So along with all the tables data, I think it's necessary to give that customer image data as well. So for that, again, I'm creating the variable img, and inside that I'm assigning tshell.querySelector, and we are selecting the image. So in the console, let's see what kind of value we are storing in that img variable. In the console, you can see there are only specific table data that do contain the customer image. So if there is no any customer image, we are getting null. Otherwise, we are getting that customer image, okay? So for that, I'm writing if image. So if there is any image at the time, let's bring this console within that if condition. And I'm writing image.src. So let's get the source of image. Okay, in the console, you can see we are getting the customer's image source. But if you have noticed there, if there is any space between that text, you are getting %20. So in order to get rid of that, you can use one function called decode URI component. So within that function, if you pass that image source, once again in the browser, did you see that? Now we are getting the readable format of that customer image source. So now what you can do is that we can give extra key value for that row object. So for that, I'm writing row object within the square bracket. You can give key something like customer image, and I'm assigning the customer image source. So now finally we have extract all the customers tables data. Now it's time to add all those data within that table data array. So for that, you can write something like table data dot push. So we are pushing the each and individual customers data. So now you can push that row object, okay? And within that row object, as you can see just a moment ago, we have stored different customers data. So now let me show you in the console. So for that, I am writing console.log table data. In the console, did you see that? Now we are getting the array, and within that array, we are getting different objects, and within that objects, there are different key and the values. And you can see at the end, we are adding extra customer image key with customer image source value, okay? You can write something like json.stringify. So with the help of this method, now we are converting all the customers data into string, and which is in the JSON format. In your console, we are getting all the string, but we are not getting the proper structure of that JSON. So for that, within that stringify method, for the second parameter, it will take the replace value. So for that replace, we'll give none. That means we are not replacing anything. And for the third parameter, you can give number of space that you want to give. So for that, you can write something like 4. That means the tab in the console. Did you see that? Now we are getting the exact structure that we can find in JSON file. We don't need this code, let's get rid of that code. And also, instead of that 4, which was the number, you can pass the string. Something like you can give backward slash t. So this represents the tab. So I think it's better to give like 4, you know, like it's easy to understand. Now instead of that console.log, let's return this value, okay? So I'm writing return keyword. So when you call that to JSON function, at that time we are returning the customer's data, okay? And now that return value, we can store that value inside the JSON variable. I mean, like you can give any name, but I'm storing that value inside the JSON variable. And next to that, let's call download file function. And within that function, let's pass the same variable, that is the JSON variable where we have stored the customer's data. And for the second parameter, let's give the file name that you want to export as. Okay, so I'm giving customerorders.json. But as you can see, we haven't created that download file function. So now let's create that download file function. As you know, I have passed there two parameters within that download file function. So for the first parameter, let's take it as text. And for the second parameter, let's take it as file name. Now within that function, let's create another variable a, and I'm assigning document.createElement. So we are creating the anchor tag, and for that anchor tag, you can give the attribute something like download, and for that attribute, you can give the file name. So with the help of this download attribute that I have given for the anchor tag, you'll be able to download the file. But in order to download, I have to give the URL or the link. So for that, again, I'm giving another attribute, href. So for that href attribute, I'm assigning backtick. So in your keyboard, just above the tab button or next to that number one key, you can find it out backtick symbol. So with the help of this backtick, it is easier to manipulate our string and the variables. So within that backtick, you can write something like data colon. Okay, like you can use blob object. You'll be able to create file. But right now, instead of that long process, I'm using the direct method. So within that colon, you can give the file type, something like I'm giving text/json, and let's give the semicolon, and you can give the character set. I'm giving UTF-8, and let's give the comma. After that, you can use dollar curly bracket. So within that curly bracket, now you can pass that customer's data. So as you can see, we are getting that customer data within that text argument. So now you can pass that text inside curly bracket, but you can see your data is passed along with that href attribute. So if you didn't skip any part of the video little moment ago, for the customer's image source, as you can see, with the help of that decode URI component function, with it decode. So now let's copy the same function, let's wrap it. Now instead of decode, we are encoding the URI component. Okay, you can see we have already created the anchor tag, and I'm assigning different attribute for that anchor tag, but our browser, it won't be able to detect our anchor tag. So for that, I'm writing document.body.appendChild. Within that append method, I'm passing A. But what I want to do is that as soon as you click option called JSON, at that time I want to perform click action. Okay, so I can write something like a.click. So with the help of this click method, it will automatically click this anchor tag that I have created. But you can see now our browser can detect that anchor element, but as soon as we click that anchor element, I want to remove that anchor tag from our browser, so that I can write something like a.remove. With the help of this code, now you'll be able to remove that anchor tag that we have given for our document. Let's take our browser to the full screen by pressing F11 key, and if I hit that JSON option, did you see that? We can now export our HTML table into JSON, and as you can see, for the file name, now you can change, I mean you can give different file name. Initially, did you see that we are getting that customer orders? So that name was manually given from JavaScript code. But what if we forgot to give that file name? So at that time, for that file name, let's give our default value like empty string. And also I have noticed that for the meme type, that's not text/json, that should be application/json. Now once again in the browser, if I hit that JSON option, now you can give any custom file name. And if I save, did you see that? We did export our HTML table into JSON file. So if I open this file, so look at that. We're getting each and every customer's data. And also, if you are interested in watching other videos, something like, you can see for this HTML table, I have given some extra functionalities, such as you can search on specific data of your HTML table along with beautiful animation. And also have added another functionality, something like you can sort or order your table's data. If that is in ascending order, then it will be arranged in descending order and vice versa. So yeah, if you are interested in creating all those features, I mean like if you want to give all those features to your HTML table, all the videos link will be even in the description below, you can check out. So that's all for today. Thank you so much for watching this video. If you did learn something, smash that like button. If you have any kind of queries, let me know in the comment box. Share this video if you think someone needs it. And also, if you haven't already hit that subscribe button and also the notification bell icon. Remember, there is always more to learn, so keep learning.